Hey guys, welcome back to the Style and Beauty Doctor here on YouTube. And in today's video, y'all, I got some clarification for y'all. There has been so much talk on these YouTube streets when it comes to sunscreens and skin of color. You know, people are demonizing chemical sunscreens. People are saying mineral sunscreens are ashy. There's two sides and they're fighting. But fight no more, because I have Dr. Pearl Grimes, board certified dermatologist. She is one of the authors of a study on visible light, iron oxide, what that has to do with skin of color, hyperpigmentation, and we're gonna talk about it in today's video. I feel so enriched. I'm actually doing this intro after I actually had the conversation with Dr. Grimes, and I feel so enriched, and I think you will too, especially if you've been confused about sunscreens and what to use and what not to use. So keep watching. A little bit more about the doctor. Dr. Pearl Grimes, MD, FAAD, is a globally recognized dermatologic expert and a leading international authority on vitiligo and pigmentation disorders. As director of the Vitiligo and Pigmentation Institute of Southern California, she treats patients from all over the world who seek her expertise and extraordinary patient care. Now, we're gonna get into the interview, but you know, sometimes you gotta preface things. But I wanted to give a shout out to Dr. Alexis Stevens, who is a board certified dermatologist in Southern Florida. And she has a YouTube channel here, which I highly recommend you checking out. She's actually the one who introduced a video to us about the iron oxides and the visible light and the type of sunscreen that you need to be using on your skin, particularly if you are suffering from hyperpigmentation. So shout out to her. I actually filmed two videos with her that are gonna show up on the channel. I'm not quite sure how it's gonna fit in the puzzle of all these videos that I've been filming this week, but make sure you subscribe to this channel and turn the notification bell on so you don't miss those videos. But shout out to her, check out her channel. All that information will be in the description box. But without further ado, let us talk about iron oxides, chemical sunscreens, physical sunscreens. Now, just a pointer as you're going into this video, some terms are gonna be used interchangeably. So organic sunscreens are chemical sunscreens, and inorganic sunscreens are physical slash mineral sunscreens. So just in case you feel like, wow, what are all these different terms? Just a little heads up. Please, please share this video. I'm gonna have timestamps in the description box. So if you want to reference back, you can have those reference points, but please watch the full video because I want to mitigate the amount of confusion that could come from just listening to one part and not listening to the full thing. Go ahead and watch the video.
The main reason I think for African Americans to wear sunscreens, I think it impacts aging, and moreover, it impacts hyperpigmentation. And while we know, Danielle, the advantages of deeply pigmented skin, you don't age as fast, it has many, many advantages. And that's been well documented in the literature now. But one of the disadvantages is, our pigment is capricious. And we're much more susceptible to hyperpigmentation, hypopigmentation. And if you look at how we do age, hyperpigmentation is a key component of the aging process in people of color, in particular, your darker skin types. You know, pigment can be an issue in lighter skinned individuals too, but they get rhytids, fine lines, coarse lines, pigment, the dyschromia of photoaging, as I call it. But we don't see that in darker skin types. You don't see coarse rhytids. You barely see fine rhytids. But you see a loss of volume. Mm-hmm. Okay? You see gravity setting mm-hmm. in. Really, you see those pigmentation issues. So right. From my perspective, probably the number one reason, more than skin cancer, and I'm not going to throw it away, it's not the number one reason.
Right.
The number one reason in my experience is pigmentation and aging. And okay. Pigmentation is even a greater issue, I think, more so than aging.
Can you give us an overview on this study on the iron oxides and the mineral sunscreen?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Again, if we look at history, typically when you look at sunscreens, they protect against ultraviolet light A and ultraviolet light B. That's what you call broad spectrum. Ultraviolet light constitutes, let's say, 5 to 7% of that, the light that hits the earth. But a much bigger component of what hits the earth is visible light. Mm-hmm. And so what we've come to find now, great, great studies on this, is visible light has the capacity to stimulate, to generate persistent hyperpigmentation in your darker skin types, your 4s through 6s. And that pigment can last a very long time. And we clearly need sunscreens that protect against visible light. Right now, the major sunscreen, the major mineral oxide that we have that protects against visible light is iron oxide. So this is what we did in the study.
Okay.
This is work that I worked with with L'Oreal Dermablend on over 2 years. And it all started, I was at the facility in New York, and it's just fascinating how it all started. And I said, guys, you need to test your products for visible light. And they did. So the first part was an in vitro study. We took the Flawless Creator formulations, and we did a spectral analysis to see in vitro if they blocked out visible light. And we looked at 3 different formulations, and clearly, not only did they block out visible light in the 400 to 700 wavelength, they blocked out UVA and UVB. And this was pretty fascinating.
Okay, so this is just the Dermablend product that has the iron oxide in it.
Yes, yes. Okay. It was the Flawless Creator brand that we tested. But my guess is if you tested other brands of Dermablend, they'd probably do the same thing because they all have a high content of iron oxide. Mm-hmm. So then the next question that we asked is, okay, if we do some human testing to really look at this in human subjects, what will happen? So we recruited 10 patients. They qualified, no exclusion criteria, i.e. sensitivity to light or getting any extra sunlight exposure. So we made 2x2 centimeter squares on their backs. And one square was untreated. Another square was just exposed to visible light. All the treated squares got 144 joules per centimeter square of visible light, which was equivalent to 1 hour of noonday sun exposure. Mm-hmm. Then we tested a standard sunscreen, UVA, UVB, and 2 formulations of the Flawless Creator. And it was fascinating what we saw. If you look at the squares that were just exposed to visible light, and so they were exposed day 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, 15 minutes after the product application, or one site just treated with light. So if you looked at the time points day 4 and then 2 weeks later, what do you think we saw? The UVA, UVB sunscreen did nothing to protect against visible light. It induced pigmentation. You could see the progression in pigmentation. If you looked at the visible light by itself stimulated pigment, no protection with the UVA, UVB sunscreen, but with the 2 formulations of Flawless Creator that we tested, one formulation contained 27% titanium dioxide and 4.8% iron oxide. The other formulation contained just 27% iron oxide. And we hit a home run in being able to block that persistent pigmentation that we see with visible light. So what's the take-home message here?
Okay.
Number one, these formulations, these cosmetic formulations were effective in blocking out visible light-induced pigmentation in the individuals in the study skin type fours. So I'm sure if we had enrolled darker skin types, we would have seen the same thing. But there are other studies in the pipeline. So that's number one. Number two, the advantage of what we tested here is it could be an immediate camouflage, but it also blocks out any visible light that you're exposed to. And the third takeaway message, I think that this study just adds additional credence to the concept that clearly visible light has the ability to induce sustained pigmentation in darker skin types. And I think it emphasizes the need even more that when we're treating hyperpigmentation in darker skin types, it's absolutely essential now that as we move forward, we need to include these metal oxide sunscreens in our formulation. So back to your question, you know, you could ask the question, should we use an organic sunscreen or inorganic, or the minerals or physical blockers? I happen to love physical blockers. One of the drawbacks has been the ashiness of these products. But the stark reality is there are formulations that don't leave ashiness on the skin. Mm-hmm. We have one in my practice that patients absolutely love. I will also, but I'm not in the business of just having everybody buy a sunscreen from me. I like giving patients options.
Okay. But which one was that? Because I know people at home are going to ask.
Well, it's a Topix product.
Okay? Oh, I love them. They make like the sprays and then they make
They make great products. I also will have patients go to Neutrogena. Mm-hmm. And get the Neutrogena products that just have zinc, and if they rub it into the skin, okay, that works. But in our study, this is what the other practical aspect of that study, I have patients use Flawless Creator. I have them, one, they can mix it with their sunscreen. Two, they can use it as a foundation. Three, they can mix it with their foundation. So at least they're getting some iron oxide in their sunscreen. And we've been doing this now for quite a while. You know, probably we started working with patients on this well over a year and a half. As soon as we realized, we saw the in vitro data, we said, what the heck, we're going to go for it. And patients have been very compliant. They like it. And as I said, different patients will use it in a different way. Some patients will come in and say, oh my God, Dr. Grimes, I love that foundation. And others will incorporate it into their favorite sunscreen, or others will just mix it in their foundation. But given the fact that, you know, many products don't contain iron oxide, at least we're giving them some. Ideally, you really need to have about, and this is a question that's frequently asked, how much iron oxide do you need in your formulation? You need about, let's say, 3.2 to 3.5% in your sunscreen. And so I think as we move forward, ideally, I would recommend that companies list the amount of iron oxide they have, or if they're working with a new ingredient, you know, just looking at the data or you know, emphasizing that. And that's the other beauty of what we did. You know, we're making this recommendation, but we backed it up with great science.
Okay. And science that was actually tested on humans, because from my understanding, a lot of the studies are tested on animals, right?
Mice. Are in models. Okay. It's just a function. Some companies don't even allow animal testing. It could have just been in an in vitro model. And we started with the in vitro model looking at spectral absorbance. And then from there, we did our testing on subjects.
Okay.
And everything, all arms connected.
All right. I really appreciate the time and effort that's being put into this. I have a couple of questions. So the iron oxide that's found in this Flawless Creative product, right? Is that something that should only be used with an inorganic sunscreen, or is it something that could also be mixed into the organic / chemical sunscreens?
You know what? It may be able to, I think you can probably mix it because there was a study that was done by a gentleman from France, Passeron, and they did a study looking at the impact of visible light. They had two formulations. One formulation just contained ultraviolet blockers, your standard chemical sunscreens. The second formulation contained those plus iron oxide. So I think that you can combine the two. And a similar work was done in around 2014 from a study from Mexico. And again, they had an ultraviolet visible light sunscreen containing iron oxide versus they had ultraviolet light, visible light versus just ultraviolet light. So I think you can combine them. Neostrata has combined them. So certainly you can.
Okay. And so in other words, it's the iron oxide that's the main point here in blocking that visible light.
Exactly.
So you could use it, whether you prefer a chemical or a mineral sunscreen, you can have that. But this, what you're saying is that the iron oxide is that extra component that's needed.
Exactly.
Okay.
That's the workhorse. Now, I think that we're going to, if you look at the science, we're going to see probably antioxidants in sunscreens that block out visible light. There's an oral antioxidant polypodium, really interesting study, which is a powerful antioxidant. And there's some work from Henry Ford, which suggests that polypodium also blocks visible light. So I think that as we move forward and given the global interest in blocking out visible light, given its deleterious effects, because it can do many of the things that we see with ultraviolet light and infrared light. It causes oxidative stress, free radical formation. It contributes to aging, angiogenesis, all a part of the aging process. So I think that we're going to have multiple options beyond iron oxide in the next several years that will be effective in blocking out visible light, because we validated the science now. We know that it's a major player. We know that it's a major player in hyperpigmentation. I think that we now understand that it's probably playing a major role in patients who have melasma. Melasma is therapeutically challenging. You can have a patient looking fabulous on Friday, and they go out and they get an extensive weekend of sun exposure, and guess what? By Monday, they may have relapsed. So if they got significant visible light, despite the fact that they were wearing their sunscreen and there was nothing in the sunscreen to protect against visible light, it all makes sense.
Gotcha. Okay. I really appreciate this because I really feel like I have more of an understanding of it. It sounds like going forward, brands are going to formulate the products with the visible light in mind, whether they use the iron oxide or whether they use some other material that helps to block that visible light. But what can people do now? Like if someone's like, okay, I have this, this is not sunscreen. That's just the first thing I picked up. But I have this sunscreen that I want to use and I want to make sure that it's going to protect me from hyperpigmentation. What are some things that people should kind of look for?
Let me just say this. Now, regular sunscreens do protect against hyperpigmentation.
Okay.
We published a paper. It was published in March and it was a 1-year study.
Okay.
And it was a study that we did in Hispanic women. I can even send you a copy of it.
I would love that.
Yeah. Do you have a copy of our visible light paper?
Yes.
Okay. So I'll send you.
Well, I have the link.
Okay. All right. I'll send you a copy of both of these papers. The sunscreen paper, just using a UVA, UVB blocker, and we monitored these women for a year. It lightened the skin.
Okay.
Okay. So I'm not saying in any way that your regular sunscreens don't work.
Okay.
What I am saying is when you look at relapse rates and that persistent, stubborn hyperpigmentation, we now know that in addition, visible light is a major player too.
Okay.
So in an ideal world, you need to block out all three. You need the ultraviolet and visible light in order to be able to optimize your outcomes.
Okay.
Does that make sense? So
that makes perfect sense.
But to go back and answer your question, you know, right now, I think the best thing that the consumer can do is read labels and ask, you know, is the formulation that they're wearing, is it in any way claiming visible light? If it's not claiming visible light, as I said, one of the beauties of what we did with the Flawless Creator and the Dermablend products, you can just take some and add it to your regimen. But as I said, I think we're going to see more and more of these products coming to the marketplace.
Just based on some of the comments and questions I've gotten from my audience, where people kind of feel like they read the study and they think that they have to kind of like make a concoction in order to mix everything up. And I'm just imagining people mixing things at home.
You mean home remedies?
Yeah, yeah. Because I've had people ask, what can they mix in their sunscreen? And my advice is usually, I would leave the sunscreen alone because you might dilute the SPF.
I agree. I would just leave it alone because you're mixing stuff that hasn't been tested. And I think that there is, when you're doing it in your kitchen, I think there is more to lose than to gain.
Right. So another question, well, not so much a question, but I guess a statement that I wanted to make to kind of clarify things for the audience. So I feel that a lot of the hesitation, well, I don't want to say hesitation. I want to feel like a lot of the precautions that are being said about, you know, the type of sun exposure, a lot of that has to do with people who have melasma, because you mentioned that melasma is something that's very, I forget the word that you use, but it's not.
I said
it's not.
Precious, yeah.
Yes, yes.
You can look fabulous on Friday and be back to square one on Monday.
Right. So there's a difference in the type of precautions that someone with melasma might take versus someone who has PIH that came from like acne or whatever, right?
Well, I think that PIH and melasma are two different animals. I can cure PIH.
Yeah.
But I can't cure melasma.
Okay.
Melasma is a very different chronic condition. Mm-hmm. So I make that clear to patients at baseline. My response is, I can treat you, Danielle, and make you look fabulous, okay? But I'm not going to cure you. There's a great likelihood you will relapse. So my advice, I really spend enormous time on photo protection because sunlight is the big kahuna in a relapse. So I typically, my approach is emphasizing you're going to have to always do sun protection. And we take you through an active phase of treatment. I get you to a maintenance phase if you relapse. Okay, we take you through that active phase again. But I think that we are going to move forward and even see new technologies for melasma and newer and better products that keep patients in remission for a longer period. And who knows, with new technologies, maybe we'll be able to cure melasma. But I do think that there's a major genetic component in melasma. I think that those individuals very often genetically have just hypersensitive melanocytes that respond to a variety of stimuli, sun exposure, hormones, medications, you name it. Whereas post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation is a response to trauma. You take away the trauma, very often you clear it up and it doesn't recur. And if you asked me the question, which one of these conditions might you need visible light protection the most? I would say melasma. But again, with aging, as I said, I think visible light is a player. So I, in an ideal world, I use the sunscreen, I think that if we can optimize our visible light protection, it's ideal.
Are there any studies on blue light's effect on the skin and any types of hyperpigmentation in skin of color?
Blue light is visible light.
Okay.
Yeah, and the spectrum of blue light that's the most harmful for pigmentation, they're those lower wavelengths of blue light.
Mm-hmm.
420 to 440, say. But that's okay. Blue light.
I thank you. I'm coming out of this feeling so like energized and full of information. People were coming to me thinking like, oh, chemical sunscreens are bad. They're going to worsen hyperpigmentation and skin of color. And I'm really glad that I could actually get the person who was part of the study.
I will tell you, I really like the mineral sunscreen. They're my favorites.
Okay.
They're clearly my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
But I think I would leave you with that. You know, there's one other message that I will leave you with, and we can talk about this more.
Okay.
And I read an article in Dark Skin, if you're using sunscreen, take some vitamin D too.
Okay,
because we're the most vitamin D deficient people on the planet. Mm-hmm. And you're not going to get it in food. You're going to spend your whole day eating.
Yeah.
It's not that easy to maintain healthy vitamin D levels from your diet. It's pretty darn hard.
Yeah.
Okay. So if we went out versus our fair skinned colleague, it would take us a day. It would take us twice as long to make adequate vitamin D. So, you know, if you look at the data on the pandemic and we're working on some amazing data on this. Take some vitamin D too. It's so important. Okay.
So I wanted to leave you with some key takeaways to kind of help summarize the video and also to mitigate confusion, because sometimes people misunderstand part of a video and then take that misunderstanding and run with it and then just go haywire. So here we go. Now, when it comes to hyperpigmentation, and there are many types of hyperpigmentation, the two ones that we talked about most in this video were melasma and post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation. As you heard from Dr. Grimes, post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, in regard to, even when you compare it to melasma, is like a walk in the park. Melasma is more like that one subject in school where you're like, I finally got it. And then the teacher came at you with some more stuff and it was like, So it's like melasma can be very tricky. People with melasma tend to need to be very precautious. They need to be very deliberate and very careful when it comes to their routines, because that sun exposure, the UV, the ultraviolet light, in addition to the visible light, can be something that can spark a melasma flare up and can make the condition worse. So people with melasma have to be very particular. So now here's the thing. You hear a lot of push for mineral sunscreens, right? I have a lot of videos on mineral sunscreens because I realized a couple of years ago that, you know, when I was doing my sunscreen reviews, they were typically on chemical sunscreens. And I've had people tell me, well, chemical sunscreens irritate me, what else can I use? And I started to kind of dabble my way into the mineral sunscreen world. Me, myself, personally, and I've said this in videos before as well, I just prefer a chemical sunscreen because they're so much easier for me, myself, personally. But because I know that it's hard to find, you know, a good mineral sunscreen for darker skin that's not going to leave that ashy cast, I do have that series. So if you're looking for those, you know, please check those out. From what I hear from dermatologists, if you have melasma, a physical sunscreen is typically going to be the better option for you for many reasons, but one of the main reasons why you'll hear dermatologists say that they love physical sunscreens more than they do chemical sunscreens is because dermatologists see a lot of the worst cases, and a lot of these cases progress because of irritation. And for some people have an irritation to chemical sunscreens. Some people have irritations to chemical sunscreens and don't even know it. So a lot of times dermatologists are going to err on the side of what's going to be the least irritating as to not cause any issues, like the type of issues that they see on a regular basis. So that's that. So another point to be taken from the conversation with Dr. Grimes is that visible light is something that also, in addition to the ultraviolet light, is something that needs to be looked at. Now, this study was done on iron oxide, which was found in the Dermablend product, but the Dermablend product is not the only product that you can find these iron oxides in. Iron oxide is what the study that she was part of was done on, but as she mentioned, iron oxide is not the only material that can block visible light. There are sunscreens that are out there that protect against visible light. Typically, it'll advertise it on the label, or if you're concerned, you can contact the brand. It's so easy to contact brands nowadays because sometimes it's as simple as, you know, DMing them on Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or what have you, or, you know, doing it the old-fashioned way and picking up the phone and giving them a call. I don't want you to feel as if you have to take all of the sunscreens that you're currently using that have worked fine for you for years and throw them out, and then to get yourself into a situation where it feels like you have to do the most in order to protect yourself from the sun. So hopefully from this interview, and I have some more coming up, so make sure you're subscribed to this channel and you turn your notification bell on so you don't miss those. Hopefully this gave you more clarification. If you have more questions, leave them in the comments below. Follow me on social, I'll leave the links in the description box, and I'll see you fine folks in my next video. Bye guys.